before I start my sharing, maybe let's look at one slide. And look what you think about this slide. What you see is actually not just a food, but smell. We all have different reactions towards smell. Some like certain food, others dislike this same type of food. And depending on how we appreciate the food, we actually respond and define the smell accordingly. For example, durian lovers, they will say how great the durian tastes like, smells like. Whereas those who do not like durian, they will say durian smells and stink like a food waste. The same thing happened to blue cheese. But there are, fortunately, there are common food that everyone enjoy eating. For example, buffet dinner or kimchi. Well, there's no better place than Singapore where we can enjoy good food, abundant food, and affordable, and all smell good. So while we enjoy eating the good food day in, day out, actually we come across a problem because we can't stop eating. And then unconsciously, we generate food waste. And so while consumers generate food waste unconsciously, since the demand is there, the food industry will be most happy to ramp up the production. And this food industry production also generate food waste in the form of side stream, like soybean residue. So you may ask, what is the problem with the food waste? Well, first of all, it smells really bad, right? This is something everybody agrees that is, it smells so bad, we all run away from it as fast as possible. I, for one, actually, I used to run pretty fast. I ran once for NTU charity drive, 100 kilometers in 6 days. But about when it comes to food waste, I didn't run as fast as others. There's a reason for that, we'll see later. And so how much food waste are we generating in Singapore? Well, the government survey has shown that if we look at the number, it's actually pretty alarming. That is, we are generating about per person per day, 2 bowls of food go to the bin chute. If we consider that on average, each of us takes 3 bowls of food a day, that means as much as we eat, the same amount of food go to the rubbish chute. So this is something quite alarming because Singapore is actually a small country. We can't really just rely on the traditional way of burning food waste. And if we look at the other countries, actually Singapore is not doing so badly. If you consider the total waste generated in Singapore, food waste take up about 10%. When you look at other countries, it can take up to 50, even 70% the food waste generated in the country. So there is a real problem. If we look at the around us, all these problems, so what people have been doing, right? The easiest way is to burn it, but it's not sustainable. Why? Because food waste tend to be moist. When we burn it, we're actually burning water. And also increase the carbon footprint along the way, so it's not sustainable. And so what can we do about this? Well, just now I mentioned that sometimes I don't run very fast, it comes to the food waste, not just I enjoy the smell, but rather we're thinking of what can we do about it. So why food waste smells? Why our dining table doesn't smell, right? It's because it's organic. It has a lot of nutrients. The smell comes from the contaminating microbes. Yeah. So why microbe is attracted to the food waste? Because there's nutrient. So if the microbe can be attracted to food waste, we can also use microbe to recover nutrients from the food waste. So here, I'd like to show you a few examples, but only 3. We have more than that, but I only share 3 with you to show that technology innovations in terms of food waste reduction can be very simple. First one, we look at the soybean residue. For those who may not know, when the soybean go to the factory, like a production line to make soy milk or bean curd, there are a lot of residue that lie behind. In Singapore, we generate about 10 million tons of soybean a year. That's a lot of soybean. What happened to this soybean? Well, it gets smelly within an hour due to this microbial, as a result of these microbial contaminations. And so what do we do usually with this soybean residue? So we either burn it or send to countries where there's an animal farm as animal feed. But for a small country like Singapore, with this hot weather, this smell is really unsustainable, and no one would like to smell this soybean, smelly soybean. We stop here, we think, right? There are so many different microbes. This type of bad microbe will generate smell, bad smell, but there are also other good microbes which we have been using to make food. So why not we use this good microbe to occupy all the surface and the space in the soybean such that the bad microbe had no time to contaminate. So this is exactly what we have done. So we subject these soybean residues to microbial fermentation, and in the process, we recover nutrient. And this, soybean residue would not smell bad at all. And so you may ask, what do you do after that? Well, we actually apply this fermented soybean residue into the alternative food space. Two examples that we have successfully applied. One is cultivated meat. A lot of people have heard of this cultivated meat as a future food. But the problem here is that it's very costly. Especially the serum medium, that's something that helps the cell to proliferate before we can see the volume of the meat. And this culture medium costs about $2,000 a liter. So when we successfully replace this culture medium with our fermented soybean residue, the cost has come down to $2 per liter. So that's a huge cost saving. In the context of Singapore's push for natural food security, urban farming, cost is one of the key factors that we need to pay attention to. The second one is that we have successfully replaced the egg yolk in the mayonnaise with this fermented soybean residue. So we have created sort of a first plant-based mayonnaise, and that was reported in the media not long ago. The second example is actually the prawn shells. The prawn shells we have, this is something that may not be familiar with a lot of people here. We actually have developed biodegradable packaging material from the smelly prawn shell. Of course, prawn shell itself should not be smelly, but for those who cook at home, you will know that if we forget to discard the prawn shells fast enough, you get very smelly, right? So which means the nutrient value in the prawn shells actually is a reason for the contamination by the bad microbes. So here we apply the same fermentation technology. So one key consideration when we develop food tech innovation is to keep things simple and low cost. So here we apply the same fermentation technology to remove the nutrient, what's left behind. So there's something that is very abundant in prawn shells, it's called chitin. Chitin is a little bit like cellulose that we find in the plant, in those plant materials. In fact, chitin is the second most abundant biopolymer in the nature. And what can we do with the chitin? Chitin is actually a food thickener. So what do we what we find it? Chitin in the, so for example, chili sauce and mayonnaise, for example. So that's the difference between this mayonnaise, creamy mayonnaise, and the water. Water is running, but mayonnaise is not running. So chitin has been used in the food industry for a very long time. So we have developed this fermentation technology to remove nutrients and then convert this chitin into biodegradable packaging material in the form of a clean film that you see here. The third example is durian husk. Our profound love toward these tropical fruit, durians. But these durian husks are very poor thing. They are actually associated with durians, guilty by association. In fact, durian husks have no smell. The problem here is that in Singapore, we consume 12 million durians a year. So you can imagine the headache for the government agency in terms of disposing these durian husks. So here, we have developed a technology just take out these cellulose from the durian husks and convert them into these hydrogel-based bandages. And these bandages are biodegradable, organic, and no toxic, and no smell, of course. So this is one way we solve the problem of reducing food waste. So I will not list down all the innovations we have developed at NTU. I think that's not the purpose. The purpose here is to show everyone here that sometimes we can, you know, stop a while to look around us and think of some innovations and then progress further. Because in our high-paced working life, sometimes we really take KPIs as our achievement, and along the way we lose sight of the big picture. And sometimes we slow down, not because we want to slow down, sometimes we are forced to slow down. For example, during the COVID-19 pandemic, we were forced to slow down and look for solutions to adapt to the disruption. Then online Zoom meeting and then Teams call come into place. And then this allow us to adapt to the disruption and progress further. In the space of a food waste reduction, we actually have slowed down on our own. So it's a proactive approach. So we slow down and look at solution and how do we develop innovation to reduce food waste. And this allow us to progress together for a better future. Some of these, we have actually moved this innovation beyond the university boundary, meaning that we have successfully partnered with local and international food industry companies to develop this innovation into commercial products. One example is probiotic ice cube that you see. It's actually in partnership with local ice makers. They are available in the NTUC finest freezer. You will see this probiotic ice cube. The advantage of this probiotic ice cube is that you can make your probiotic beverages itself instead of getting a probiotic yakult, right? The second one is antimicrobial masks, which were distributed to all the households by our government at the peak of COVID-19 in 2020. Very few people know that the antimicrobial compound in the antimicrobial mask is actually the innovation for NTU. So you may ask, maybe it's time for us to pause, ask a question together. What can we do together to reduce food waste? It can't possibly be that everyone move into the innovation. I'll be very stressed because a lot of competition. And also, it may not be practical to ask everyone to start playing around with the food waste at home, right? So when we talk about food waste reduction, we also need to look at a different perspective. So just now I mentioned our innovations is to reduce the food waste which has been generated. The other aspect we need to pay attention is how to minimize the generation of food waste. I think here is something that everyone can contribute together. As you can see, you don't need rocket science to develop innovation for the food application. Here, we're talking about how to reduce the generation of food waste. We can start from home, you see. For example, first simple tip is that finish each one's dining plate. This is very easy. There are two advantages of finishing the dining plate. First, we don't generate food waste at home. Second, you feel fuller. What happens when you feel fuller? chances are when you go to grocery shopping, you buy lesser. So usually, if you go to supermarket after a meal, be it breakfast, lunch, or dinner, chances are your shopping trolley will not be full. Which this also help in your home that your fridge will not be full also, right? And this is one way to actually reduce the generation of food waste. At my home, so when I have time, actually I'm a kind of good cook. The difference between me and other chefs at home is that I don't follow recipes. So I will cook delicious dinner from anything we can find in the fridge. Delicious, that's important. Otherwise, you anyhow cook, also no good. So my family has given me a very fond name. So when I cook, it's called no signboard, no menu, because they don't know what's going to come out. But along the way, you can see that I actually help the household to reduce the accumulation of food in the fridge. As we know, actually, when you buy too much food, you tend to stuck in the fridge, and then you don't even know what's behind the first layer of food. So that contributes to the food waste generation. And we also know that in a fridge, not all the food can last forever, because microbes that contaminate the food, they are not dead. They're just slower in growth in the fridge. Therefore, if we practice these a few tips, we can actually contribute to the reduction of food waste. So over the years, our fridge getting smaller over the years at home, and then it's never full. So I think that there are some practical tips that we can use to reduce food waste generation. And so with this collective effort, we hope that one day we will achieve that to remove this 2 bowl of food waste every day in Singapore. And then in the future, we also hope that all the smells that when we go out to the restaurant or anywhere, all the smells that we can you know, enjoy, and none of them will come from food waste. And together, we hope that use this collective effort, we can actually prevent today's food waste from becoming tomorrow's food shortage. Thank you.